Now, 2 weeks ago, and it was 2 weeks ago was the second class in our series, we began looking at what the Old Testament has to say on the subject of homosexual conduct. And we saw how in the beginning, in the beginning, God built a woman, a sexual counterpart to the man, from the bone and flesh that he removed from Adam. And it's because of the complementary fit of man and woman, based on the fact the woman was created out of the man, that man and woman joined back together in the sexual union of marriage. And as indicated by Jesus, and as Jesus indicated in Matthew 19, appreciate that, marriage and the sexual intimacy that are part of it are intended by God to be between the two sexes He created in the beginning. And we saw in Deuteronomy 22:5. So we saw 2 weeks ago in Deuteronomy 22:5. First, you see in this foundational question of God creating the woman as a complementary fit to the man in Genesis. And then we saw in Deuteronomy 22:5 that the male-female distinction established at creation is so fundamental that disregarding that distinction or camouflaging that distinction, even by means of cross-dressing, is an abomination to God. So certainly, as I made the point 2 weeks ago, certainly disregarding the male-female distinction by taking the role of the opposite sex in sexual intercourse, certainly that's sinful. And we see that clearly expressed in Leviticus 18, 22, and 20:13. Now, I wanted to say at the beginning, I just remembered, I realize that in this study I'm using words that aren't often spoken in church gatherings, but that's necessary. You see, I have to address the subject properly. I'm being as clinical as I can, but I need to say these things to deal with the arguments that are made, because I want to address them and show what's wrong with them. Now, this is declared explicitly the idea that having, you know, homosexual conduct is explicitly condemned. You see here in Leviticus 18:22 and 20:13, and as we saw 2 weeks ago, the determining factor in the condemnation is the sex of the participants. It's the sex of the participants. It is not their social status. It is not their relationship with one another. It is the sex of the participants. And I explained that we can know that the prohibition of homosexual conduct, I'm just reviewing now, by the way. I'll get to where we ended, but after 2 weeks, I wanted to bring you back up to where we were. And as I explained, we can know that the prohibition of homosexual conduct stated in these verses isn't a temporary purity regulation given to the people of Israel during the time, the era of the Mosaic Covenant, that it's not a matter of ritual contamination for Jews, but rather it's a matter of moral conduct. And I went through how we can see that the indicators of ritual contamination are not here. And just to remind you, here's Robert Gagnon's summary of the reasons, his rejection of the ritual contamination claim, trying to say that's what the ban on homosexual conduct is. Just as a reminder for you, you see that homosexual conduct's called an iniquity or sin, and that's not what you get with ritual contamination. Doesn't permit absolution merely through ritual acts. And so you just see those just to remind you of how we can know that the ban on homosexual conduct in Leviticus is not a matter of just ritual contamination. And on top of all that, the fact the prohibition of homosexual conduct is repeated in the New Testament, as we'll see eventually when we get to the New Testament, but that fact, it establishes conclusively that it is part of God's ongoing or continuing will and not a temporary requirement given to Israel as part of the Mosaic Covenant. So we know that because Paul repeatedly applies the condemnation. Now, nevertheless, There are those who attempt to deny the undeniable, to deny the fact that the ban on homosexual conduct continues into the new covenant by arguing that the prohibition of homosexual conduct, it is analogous to the ban or the prohibition of having sex with a woman during her period. And at the end of the class last week, right at the very end, I set out the argument that is made this way. I like to schematize things so you can see clearly what the argument is. And the argument is that, look, the prohibitions of having sex with a menstruating woman and engaging in homosexual conduct, that they are sufficiently similar, that they are similar enough in the relevant particulars, that they must be treated the same with regard to their applicability under the new covenant. So similar enough that they must be treated the same in terms of whether they're applicable in the new covenant. The proscription of having sex with a menstruating woman is not applicable under the new covenant. Therefore, the proscription of engaging in homosexual conduct is not applicable under the new covenant. That's the argument that is made. Now, since the ban on homosexual conduct, as I've said, since it's applied repeatedly in the New Testament, we can know it was not a temporary Jewish-specific matter, Jewish-specific element of the Mosaic Covenant, but that it's a matter of moral instruction that continues into the New Covenant. So that's clear, as we'll see when I discuss Paul's teachings on it. So we can know that that's not the case. So we know that this argument, even though the logic is sound, the argument is unsound because one or more of the premises are false. We can know that this argument is wrong because it leads to a conclusion that we know is false. And I gave you the illustration. All men have red hair. Ashby is a man, therefore Ashby has red hair. Well, you can see that's wrong. What hair I have, it's not red. So you know before you analyze the premises that it has brought you to a false conclusion, so you know there's something wrong with the premises, even before you go and investigate them and analyze them. Now, that's where we ended 2 weeks ago. The first thing to note with regard to this argument by analogy to the ban on sex with a menstruating woman, the first thing to note is that there appears to be two different offenses related to having sex with a woman during her period. There's no doubt that the sexual relations with a menstruating woman that are under consideration in Leviticus 15:24, there's no doubt that those sexual relations involve only a ritual defilement. You see, the man is rendered unclean. And he's rendered unclean for a period of 7 days. That's your classic ritual contamination. You see that you're contaminated for a certain period. So he's rendered unclean for a period of 7 days. And that parallels the ritual, the period of ritual uncleanness for the woman by virtue of her period. There's nothing immoral about having a period. But it renders one ritually unclean. Just like there's nothing immoral about married people having sexual relations, but it renders them unclean, ritually unclean. You see, so clearly here, the offense that's being dealt with here is a matter of ritual uncleanness. See, just as the woman who has a period is ritually unclean for 7 days, just as the furniture on which she lies or on which she sits is rendered unclean, you see, that's how ritual contamination is. It's transmitted by touch. So you see that. So the man who lies with her during that time is made unclean. As the furniture is made unclean, the man who lies with her is made unclean. It's no more a matter of sin, as I said, than the uncleanness that results from ordinary marital intercourse. Certainly not sinful, but as you see in Leviticus 15:18, which isn't on here. But it renders one what? Ritually unclean. So clearly in this situation, the offense that's being discussed here is a matter of ritual contamination. And if that were the only text, we clearly would be dealing with a matter of ritual contamination under the Mosaic Covenant. something that has no ongoing applicability in the new covenant. But the prohibition, when you get to Leviticus 18:19 and Leviticus chapter 20, verse 18, of having sex with a menstruating woman, it does not speak of the man becoming unclean. And it makes no reference to purification by the passage of time or by washing. You don't get any of that. Rather, Leviticus chapter 20, verse 18 speaks more ominously of the participants being cut off from among the people, which most understand as a reference to some kind of punishment that is administered by God directly in His own way and in His own time, perhaps referring to the extinction of one's lineage. But you see a clear difference here. So in 15, we have clearly a matter of ritual contamination, but when you get to 20, you don't have this talk of uncleanness. You don't have this time where you delay and the impurity is removed by the passage of time. You don't have anything about washing. You don't have anything about transmitting it through touch. And you have this penalty that is they're cut off. They are cut off. The point is that the texts themselves indicate there's a difference between the situation in Leviticus 15 and the situation that's being addressed in Leviticus 18 and 20, though both of them involve sex with a menstruating woman. But there is a difference here, and what makes the most sense is that Leviticus 15:24, it refers to inadvertent sex with a menstruating woman, her condition being unknown beforehand. Or perhaps begins during the sexual intercourse. The other, in 18 and 20, it addresses a knowing and willful intercourse with a woman during her period. That's the way, to me, to make the most sense of the two, where you have Leviticus 15 and Leviticus 20. The text indicates we're talking about different situations. Well, what is that difference? What I'm suggesting to you is the best way to understand it is that 15 deals with inadvertent contact with menstrual blood, not knowing. In 2018, it is a knowing and a willful intercourse with a woman during her period. Now, the homosexual argument by analogy, this argument by analogy, doesn't work with either of these offenses. It doesn't work with either of these offenses. It doesn't work with the inadvertent ritual contamination offense of Leviticus 15:24, because in that case, premise one is false. You remember? Sufficiently similar, got to stand or fall together. This one doesn't continue, therefore that one doesn't continue. Well, in the inadvertent ritual contamination, premise one is false because they are not sufficiently similar. The prohibition of homosexual conduct clearly is not a matter of ritual contamination for the reasons I gave 2 weeks ago and for the reasons I summarized at the beginning of this class through the quote from Robert Gagnon. So those offenses are not sufficiently similar that they have to be treated the same in terms of their ongoing applicability under the new covenant. So in the first offense, Leviticus 15, the argument doesn't work. And the homosexual argument doesn't work with the knowing and willful offense that you see in Leviticus 18:19 and 20:18, because in that case, neither of the premises can be established. Now we know the argument's wrong because it leads to a conclusion that we know is wrong. How do we know it's wrong? Because Paul employs the ban on homosexual conduct in the new covenant. So we know it continues. So an argument that winds up concluding it does not continue, we know is wrong. Okay, but we're now looking at the why. Why would it be wrong? What is wrong with the premises? And I'm telling you that neither of the premises can be established in this case. Contrary to premise two of the argument, where it says both of them, they're sufficiently similar, they have to be treated the same in terms of the ongoing effect into the new covenant. This one doesn't continue into the new covenant, therefore the ban on homosexual conduct doesn't continue in the new covenant? Well, contrary to premise two, the idea that one doesn't continue, many Christians, Old Testament scholars Roy Gain and Michael Brown being just two examples, believe the prohibition in Leviticus 18, 19, and 20, 18 of having sex with a woman during her period does continue into the new covenant. This willful, deliberate having sex with a woman during her period, that continues to be a ban in the new covenant. And you can see support for that in Ezekiel chapter 18, verses 5 through 9, and Ezekiel chapter 22, verses 6 through 12. Those texts there, they group approaching a woman during her time of menstrual impurity, they group it with other obligations and prohibitions that are generally accepted as having ongoing applicability in the new covenant. Things like idolatry, adultery, incest, robbery, and mistreating the poor. So when you look in those Ezekiel texts, you see that it's grouped with those kinds of things. So that supports the idea that no, this deliberate and willful having sex with a woman during her period, that does continue as a ban into the new covenant. So you have those associations in Ezekiel 18 and 22. You have the seriousness of the penalty that accompanies this offense in Leviticus chapter 20, 18, being cut off. In contrast to what you have in Leviticus 15, where it's simply, he's unclean for 7 days, just a passage of time. Well, here you have this idea of 2018, this more serious penalty of being cut off, and the fact the offense is grouped in Leviticus chapter 20, verses 17 to 21, with prohibitions of certain degrees of incest. Okay, so we have where it's grouped in Ezekiel. We have in Leviticus, it's grouped with certain degrees of incest, all of which suggest it's an ongoing and transcultural moral concern. That is what leads people to believe, no, this 2018 prohibition of deliberately having sex with a woman during her period does in fact continue into the new covenant. It does in fact continue into the new covenant. So in that case, you see, that's contrary to premise two. They say, well, they're sufficiently the same. They stand or fall in terms of their ongoing applicability. This one doesn't continue, therefore that one doesn't continue. Well, this one continues. You see? This one continues. And so you have that issue there. But even if one accepts that the prohibition in Leviticus 18, 19, and 20:18 of deliberately and willfully having sex with a woman during her period, even if one accepts that that is not applicable. Okay, I was first suggesting to you, contrary to premise two, that it may very well go on. Many scholars think that, and there are reasons for thinking that. The grouping in Ezekiel, the grouping there, the severe, more severe penalty. Okay, but now I'm saying to you that even if one doesn't accept that the prohibition, if it doesn't accept that it's, you know, the other, if accepts that it's not applicable, okay? Even if one accepts that the prohibition of deliberately having sex, you accept that it's not applicable under the new covenant, contrary to what I was just, you know, the point I was just making, if you take the other side and say, all right, it's not applicable, it does, in fact, does not continue into the new covenant, the homosexual argument by analogy, it still cannot be established. It still cannot be established because, contrary to premise one, there are things that distinguish the two situations, that distinguish the willful, deliberate of having sex with a woman during her period and the prohibition of homosexual conduct, so that they need not stand or fall together even if this one doesn't continue. I hope you're following me. I know this gets a bit complicated. I'm almost through with this part. But I wrestled with what I wanted to say, and I want to say these things because I think it's important to address, because these are the kinds of arguments that are made. Okay, so premise one, you see, the contrary to premise one, these things are different. They're distinctive, so that the offenses need not stand or fall together in terms of their ongoing applicability. Indeed, you think about those who make this argument. Those who make this argument, they recognize that the proscriptions of adultery, incest, and bestiality do not stand or fall with the proscription of having sex with a menstruating woman. They recognize that. Nobody goes and says, no, it's because sex with a menstruating woman allegedly doesn't continue into the new covenant, well, then it's okay to commit adultery or bestiality. They recognize that those situations are distinctive so that they don't stand or fall with the ongoing applicability of having sex with a menstruating woman into the new covenant. They recognize that. So what they have to demonstrate is that the ban on homosexual conduct is more like having sex with a menstruating woman than it is like adultery, incest, and bestiality. And they cannot do that. Leviticus chapter 10, or chapter 20, verses 10 to 16, the sexual sins that carry the death penalty, they are grouped together. And these are adultery, various degrees of incest, homosexual conduct, and bestiality. Now, none of the other sexual sins identified in that chapter carry the death penalty, which suggests, does it not, that homosexual conduct is more closely analogous to adultery, incest, and bestiality than it is to having sex with a woman during her period. Because they recognize those things continue, so they then must say, okay, the ban on homosexual conduct is more analogous to having sex with a woman during her period than it is to adultery, incest. But you look and you say, well, here they're grouped with the only sexual sins in Leviticus 20 that are punished with the death penalty. And so that indicates, no, it's more analogous to these than it is to the woman having sex with a woman during her period. And moreover, adultery, incest, bestiality, and homosexual conduct, they all involve violations of absolute sexual prohibitions that are tied to the identity of the person or things involved. There's no circumstance under which a man can have sex with his neighbor's wife, his father's wife, or an animal. Those are completely off limits. And the prohibition against having sex with one's wife when she's menstruating, on the other hand, that's a matter of timing. It is not an absolute identity prohibition. It's a matter of timing. You see, timing during the normal and proper sexual relationship of marriage, it doesn't carry the same sense of unnaturalness. So what I'm saying to you is that it looks like the willful, deliberate ban on the ban on willful and deliberate sex with a woman during her period does continue. But even if one says, no, it doesn't continue, the argument by analogy still won't work, because there are reasons for believing that the two aren't sufficiently similar in relevant particulars that they must stand or fall together in terms of ongoing applicability. All right. The bottom line is that the argument is unsound. Both of its premises are questionable for the reason that I've given, and we can be certain that one of them is false because the conclusion is patently false. The idea that it doesn't continue into the new covenant is patently false, as we will see when we study Paul's teachings however many weeks down the road. Now, some have tried, so that's that whole idea. I hope I didn't beat that to death, but this is where people see they come in and use these kinds of things, and some of them you just have to get down and try to chop into little pieces and try to deal with. Okay? Now, some have tried to avoid the Levitical prohibitions of homosexual conduct that we in 1822 and in 2013, claiming that they apply only to those who are engaged, homosexual conduct that's engaged in as part of worshiping an idol. You may have run across this. If you do any reading, you've run across this. In other words, they claim, look, it's not homosexual conduct itself that is condemned in Leviticus, but it's only homosexual conduct when it's mixed up with pagan idolatry. It is only homosexual conduct that is done in the context of worshiping an idol. Now, few today give this argument any credence. and for good reason. The fact the prohibition of homosexual conduct in Leviticus 18:22 follows a verse, 18:21, the fact that it follows a verse proscribing child sacrifice to Molech does not mean that the ban on homosexual conduct is restricted to cases of idol worship. The verse right before 18:21, the verse right before the ban on child sacrifice, it's a ban on adultery. And nobody argues that adultery is only wrong in context of idol worship. Right? So somebody said, well, 18:22 follows a ban on child sacrifice in the context of Molech. Therefore, 18:22 is restricted to only homosexual conduct engaged in context of idol worship. You say, well, the verse right before the child sacrifice is adultery. So do we want to say that verse means that adultery is only banned in the context of idol worship? Well, nobody says that. You see, nobody says that. And moreover, the prohibition of homosexual conduct in Leviticus 20:13, as you can see here, is nowhere near the reference to child sacrifice. It's nowhere near it. Rather, it's sandwiched between prohibitions of adultery, incest, and bestiality. And none of those sins are thought to be restricted to the context of idolatry. Right? So there's no reason to think that's the case with homosexual conduct. And as I've already pointed out, in the first or second week, no, it would have been the second week, the prohibition of homosexual conduct in Leviticus 18:22 and 20:13 is a man having sex with a male. Not with a man having sex with a male cult prostitute. And if the writer had intended to limit the prohibition to a male cult prostitute, he could have said that plainly. But he did not. So it's not the least bit surprising that Leviticus 18:22 and Leviticus 20:13 were never understood to be restricted to idol worship. Here's what Robert Gagnon says. I mentioned Gagnon is probably the leading scholar in the world on the subject. Okay? But I just let you know, that's who he is, that's who I'm quoting. This is his research on it. He says, in the history of the interpretation of these Levitical prohibitions, they are never construed as indicating only homosexual acts in the context of cult prostitution. On the contrary, they're taken in the broadest possible sense. And we'll see this down the road, because down the road I'm going to look at how did the Jews understand this? How did the early church understand this? So we will first look at what Scripture says, and then we will look and see, well, are we off base? Are we looking at this in some odd way? Or are we understanding this in line with how Jews and Christians for millennia have understood this? And if we are, well, that's a really strong indication we're on the right track. Okay, but Gagnon says, on the contrary, they're taken in the broadest possible sense. For example, the first century Jewish historian Josephus explained to Gentile readers that, quote, the law of Moses recognizes only sexual intercourse that is according to nature, that which is with a woman, but it abhors the intercourse of males with males, end quote, against Appian. There are no limitations placed on the prohibition as regards age, slave status, idolatrous context, or exchange of money. The only limitation is the sex of the participant. Now, even scholars who support homosexual unions, who are advocates of that, even those scholars admit that the Levitical prohibitions are absolute and are not limited to idolatrous forms of homosexual conduct. William Loder, who is a proponent of homosexual unions, he's written more on the issue of sexuality in ancient Judaism and early Christianity than any other scholar. Loder says the wider context of the Levitical prohibitions goes beyond the cultic, as does the verse about bestiality which follows. Most scholars conclude that Leviticus 18:22 does condemn same-sex anal intercourse between males in general and is not restricted to particular settings. And that is a consensus that Loder himself accepts. So here we have people who are proponents of it, acknowledging that the argument of trying to restrict this to idol worship is bogus. It is a grasping of at straws. Gerald Shepherd, who's another supporter of homosexual unions. I do not think that the text in Leviticus can be read from a historical perspective as applicable only to cult prostitution, because they stand in the context of other laws regulating general immoral conduct, such as incestuous relationships, adultery, and bestiality. I find Edwards's historical speculation concerning the restriction of the abomination formula to cultic violations weak and uncompelling. It is this idea of going back and rummaging through the Bible and trying to get it to say what you want it to say instead of listening to it. And that's what I'm trying to get across here, what the Bible says. Indeed, for this I want water. The fact, Leviticus 18:22 and Leviticus 20:13 are a blanket prohibition of all homosexual conduct is evident from the fact homosexual relations are not addressed in the numerous laws in Leviticus 18 and Leviticus 20 against incest. Now follow me on this and think about this. A man is specifically prohibited from having sex with his mother, his sister, his daughter, his granddaughter, his aunt, and his daughter-in-law. But nothing is said about a man having sex with his father, his brother, his son, his grandson, his uncle, or his son-in-law. And that omission only makes sense if the prohibition of homosexual conduct is absolute, if it carries no exceptions. That only makes sense. You see, if that were not the case, if some homosexual conduct was permissible, say, voluntary sex between adults, then incest would need to be excluded from the universe of permissible homosexual conduct. It's the absoluteness of the ban in Leviticus 18:22 and 20:13 that explains the silence regarding homosexual incest. That's why you don't get a thing about don't have sex with your father or your brother, that kind of thing. Why? Because all homosexual conduct is banned. You see? That's the only thing that makes sense of that omission, is that it's absolute. Well, some have asserted that what's another argument that people make, trying to get around the clear statements that you have here? Not only do you have those statements, but you have the clear theology of the creation of man and woman as these sexes. You have Jesus' comment. You have the Deuteronomy comment. You have the Leviticus comment. And we're only in the Old Testament, and we're not through there. You see? So it is just this trying to get around these things. That's why it takes so long, because you have all these people trying to craft arguments. All new. You know, not used for millennia, but in the last 60 years, all of a sudden we've been enlightened. You see, we've been enlightened. Now, some have asserted that the Levitical prohibitions were based on the fact homosexual intercourse wastes seed and couldn't lead to procreation. So they say, see, that's what it's based on. It's only banned because it's non-procreative. It wastes seed. And since, you know, given that non-procreative sex, contraception, is accepted by Jews and Protestants, they say, well, look, then you see the basis of the ban on homosexual conduct no longer holds. Because what that ban is based on is a lack of procreative work, wasting of seed. But Jews and Protestants accept the legitimacy of non-procreative sex. So therefore, the basis of the ban is no longer holds. But there's no reason. There's no reason to accept the premise that the prohibition was based on wasting seed or on the non-procreative aspect of homosexual conduct. Nothing is said about that. That is simply imported into the text. On the contrary, the reason for the prohibition is explicitly stated to be the sameness of the sexes involved. Lying with a male as with a woman. It is the gender discomplementarity. That's the reason that's given. So we want to ignore that and just import into it something that's not there because that's what I want it to say. As I said, that's no way to handle the Bible. And things are prohibited in the holiness code. That's what scholars call Leviticus 17 through 26. Things are prohibited in the holiness code that can lead to procreation, such as incest and adultery. And some things that cannot lead to procreation are not prohibited, such as heterosexual sex with a barren woman or a pregnant woman. Those aren't prohibited. So that's obviously not the rationale for it. Despite it doesn't say that's the rationale, it gives an alternate rationale, which is a gender discomplementarity. And then you see in the Leviticus code, prohibitions that don't fit that. So I hope you can see how much of this is just a reaching and a twisting and a trying to say, well, I want this to mean this. Again, the primary problem of homosexual intercourse is that it violates the sexual boundaries established by God at creation. Here's what Gagnon says. The particularly abhorrent character of homosexual intercourse cannot be explained solely or primarily by its lack of procreative potential. Rather, it is to be traced to its character as a flagrant transgression of the most fundamental element of human sexuality, sex or gender. Homosexual intercourse requires a radical gender bending of human sexuality by the very creatures whom God placed in charge of the good, ordered creation. That's what I said. You see how fundamental this is when you see in Deuteronomy 22 that it's an abomination to mask or camouflage it, even to the extent of cross-dressing. Well, here in homosexual conduct, you see that just a fuller outworking of that. And that's what's behind that ban. Now, some have even argued that Leviticus 18:22 and 20:13 specifically address only intercourse between men. I say, okay, I see that I'm kind of caught there. But it only addresses intercourse between men. So other forms of homosexual conduct, such as lesbianism, they are permitted. Well, here's what Gagnon says about that. I just kind of thought this was right. He says, such a conclusion is akin to arguing that because any particular corpus of law in the Old Testament explicitly proscribes only penetrative intercourse in the case of incest, adultery, fornication, rape, and bestiality, then we can assume that fondling one's stepmother or a neighbor's wife or a virgin or an animal would be acceptable behavior in ancient Israel. That wouldn't follow, would it? Wouldn't it be that the implication is that, yeah, it would be. But so that's the idea, and there are several reasons why female-female sexual conduct wasn't specifically addressed in Leviticus. And as we'll see later, Paul in Romans 1:26 leaves no doubt that sexual relations between two women is forbidden. So that argument doesn't work. Now, others have tried to dismiss not only the Levitical prohibitions in 18:22 and 20:13. They've tried to dismiss not only the Levitical prohibitions, but all biblical condemnation of homosexual conduct by claiming that people in the ancient world were unaware of what they call homosexual orientation. That we've got new knowledge now, and these people back then, they were unaware of that. And therefore, none of these things work. None of these things apply. Because they were written in an ignorance of what we now know to be a homosexual orientation. Well, that's just nonsense. Okay, that's nonsense, and it does nothing to avoid the biblical proscription, as I will explain when we discuss the Apostle Paul's writings. They were indeed well aware of these things. And I will have many people. I will have lesbians and other people from that side acknowledging that. So this isn't something over here, you know, done in some, fundamentalist corner. None of this is. This is all general understanding. Now, you'll be happy to know that I'm now moving off Leviticus 18, 22, and 20:13. Okay? But all of that, see, had to be done because those are so clear and specific, they've generated a lot of ways of people trying to get around them. And none of those ways carried any weight. They don't in current scholarly circles, except there are pockets where you have people advocating these things. Okay? But in Genesis 18:16 through 19:11, I see we're going to run out of time, but I'll at least introduce this maybe. We see that there you have the question of Sodom and Gomorrah. Okay, so you've got the Genesis, the creation text, Jesus' comment on that in Matthew 19. You've got the Deuteronomy text, the Leviticus text, and of course we have the Sodom and Gomorrah, where in the latter part of Genesis 18, we see that God had determined to destroy the sinful cities of Sodom and Gomorrah. They were paragons of wickedness. These cities were paragons of wickedness. And the Lord says in 18:20, Genesis 18:20, that the outcry against the city was great and their sin was very grave. And as two angels in the form of men, as they're heading for Sodom, God agrees in response to Abraham's plea not to destroy the city if only 10 righteous people can be found. If only 10 righteous people in the whole city can be found, I won't destroy it. That's how bad the city was. And in Genesis 19, the two angels arrive in Sodom in the evening. Lot takes them into his home, and then all the men of the city, young and old, they surround Lot's house and demand that the visitors be brought out so they can have sex with them. And Lot begs the mob not to act so wickedly. Not to act so wickedly. And he even offers them his virgin daughters to dissuade them from raping the men who, unbeknownst to them, are angels. But he offers that, and the angels pull Lot back into the house, blind the men, and the next day Sodom and Gomorrah and the cities of the plain except Zoar were destroyed. Now, next week, Lord willing, we'll discuss the implications. And the question in Sodom and Gomorrah is the homosexual element a compounding offense? In addition to the rape and the lack of hospitality, does the inspired writer intend the reader to understand that it is a compounding offense, that these people are paragons of wickedness? Is it more like somebody raping his mother? Or you see that's an aggravating circumstance that you're supposed to say, boy, these guys are like the worst? Or is it like a rape that doesn't have that aggravating circumstance? What I'm going to suggest to you quite clearly is that this is to be understood as an aggravating circumstance. Okay, thanks for coming.